the, as there's not a public, we'll have publics. Can we look at the meet, a public comment, can we look at the minutes and see if there's anything that would like, anybody would like to clarify something? Anything?
I thought they were good.
Yeah, I thought they were excellent.
Yeah.
I loved how brief they were and, but got the points, you know?
Yeah, they're probably the best we've had.
What?
They're probably the best minutes we've had in a long time.
Thank you, thank you. Can I make a motion that we approve the minutes?
Yeah.
And second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Lori.
Can I just ask?
Anybody opposed? Okay. Introduction of new commissioners, Davina. How are you? Tell us a little bit about yourself. Why did you want to join the Human Rights Commission?
Well, I had been on the school committee years ago for a long time, but I'd always meant to do something else. And somehow the time passed and I wasn't. And there's a lot going on in the world that makes me think that this is the time to get out there and be counted. So I think it's really that.
Okay. That's thank you. Thank you.
You know, this is the time to step up and do something. I don't feel totally clear exactly what you do and don't do, and you know, that I'm trying to. But I learned from the school committee, I need to keep quiet and just listen for the first 6 months and ask my neighbor.
Well, please do participate, ask questions and make comments.
Yes. No,
basically what we do is we advise the mayor and the city council and anybody else that we have, when we come up with some idea, we want to show our support for an event, for an idea, for a new policy, whether it exists or not. If we come up with an idea for this city to institute, then we write it up, we being one of us, and then the rest of us comment. And then we take it over to either the city council or to the mayor's office directly. He wants us to be his advisors. And we can also sponsor, we can produce events as well. That's something this commission used to do a few years ago. We used to celebrate the December 10 as when the Declaration of Human Rights was first declared in 1948. And a couple of years ago we talked about creating like awards to give to different people in the community who show leadership in human rights. So that's something that can be taken up, for instance. Anybody want to add anything?
I see it as educational.
One of our most recent activities was that we wanted to show full support for Catholic Charities initiative to bring refugees to Northampton.
Yes.
So one of the things that Catholic Charities did, which you may be aware of, was to hold house parties.
Yes.
And so this commission hosted such house party.
Yeah, and I was going to go and something came up. I can't remember what happened.
Mm-hmm.
But I've been going, I'm a psychotherapist, and I have been going to the one for the therapist. So
the working group.
The working group, the mental health group, yes.
Do you all want to discuss the draft?
Do we want to get someone to take the minutes?
Oh, thank you, Lori. Does somebody want to take the minutes? Like Karen? Who did such an excellent job last night.
I will do my best.
Thank you. Do you all want to discuss this draft, or what were the questions? I wasn't here for that November meeting, and you said that people had questions.
Yeah, we
comments.
Didn't really talk about it, so.
Oh.
We didn't.
Well, I printed a copy here. Hi, Brian.
Hello.
So here's Brian. Brian, that's Davina. She's the newest member of the
Human
Rights
Commission.
Hey, Brian.
I'm so sorry to be late.
We're at the part of the agenda where we're talking about the affirmation letter about human rights to send to the paper in light of Trumpism, just to affirm that the city obviously supports human rights, even if it can't codify it into law in every single instance, it does support the idea.
Do you have a copy of it? I'm sorry.
Here's my copy, Joel. I brought it for you.
You know me well. I had just a couple of questions on it,
okay.
And the reason we kind of tabled it was because it really wasn't fair to discuss it and talk about it without the author here.
Okay.
One of the things I had, and I have to go through it again, is I have no problem with what it says or anything, but I wanted to make sure that there wasn't anything in there where it leaves open for anyone who disagrees to pinpoint something and then take that as the whole thing, which we see happens continually. And there was one part in here, and you're gonna have to bear with me.
Sure, take your time. While Joel is looking, did it at all sound partisan to anybody, or those to me are red flags that we want to be? This is not about the people who voted for Trump.
I think it's gonna. We're gonna need to read it out loud, and are we gonna edit this as a group?
Dios mío,
unfortunately, you have to do that to some extent, because if you do it behind the scenes, it becomes deliberation.
Might we read it a paragraph at a time and. And then comment.
Okay, can I? This is my fear. Edit by committee is the worst thing that can happen. You know this. Mm-hmm. What did you all do for Lori's resolution? Can we follow that?
We did the same thing.
Yeah. And we all had a copy.
I saw a letter that just said, great, thanks, Lori. I saw emails that said that. Was
no.
Was there more discussion?
In the meeting,
uh-huh.
People said they wanted this fixed or that fixed or this added.
Okay.
So I took notes. And then I did all that and sent it out.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I mean, in all the committees that I sit on, you have to if you're producing a joint document, because you just can't do it behind the scenes.
No, this is not doing it behind the scenes. This was either like do, you know, a couple of comments, thumbs up, thumbs down.
So what will it take, 10 minutes?
Not line editing.
Yeah, I don't think we need line. I mean, I found where my question was.
Okay, where's your question?
Well, You mentioned here we are in a troubling time when the leader of another country whose own history is scarred with the Holocaust. That just worries me. Somebody's going to go, that's vague. What other country are you talking about? That was my.
Oh, when that's Angela Merkel. Yes, we will read it, Christine. Yes, that was a reference to Angela Merkel, to say even Angela Merkel from, you know, Germany, which is known as like for the horrors that they committed in you know, just not that many years ago.
Well, I know that, you know that.
Right. should that stay in there, or should we just take that whole reference out?
I think we should take it out. I think it's a red herring.
Yeah, I think it's highlighting something that we don't need to highlight.
Okay, I'm going to delete
that.
That's
just my own.
Delete Germany.
Whoever you compare with other countries, you know, in any way.
That's right.
To me,
it could be an endless comparison, you're right. Okay, Christine, you want to do that?
I do. The election of Donald Trump as President of the United States has caused terror in many communities right here in Northampton and nationwide. Arabs, blacks, Jews, Latinos, LGBTQ, people with disabilities, people with chronic illnesses, women and children, correctly because of the heinous things he has said about members of these communities and how he has conducted himself. That is a run-on sentence.
I can see you in your writing.
All right.
So what are you trying to say here? It's caused terror in many communities, and then you would have to say, including right here in Northampton,
right.
And then you would have to say which communities in Northampton were affected, because you can't then just jump to the nationwide thing, because if people are going to be reading this, they're going to say, who in Northampton has been terrorized by this? I mean, it's kind of a big accusation.
Well, the police chief has already received incident reports, but I guess that would be something to add on to that.
More details.
But, yeah, I don't want to,
I'd make the suggestion that we change cause terror to awakened fear.
Mm-hmm. Terror is one of those red herrings.
Well, yeah, it's a trigger kind of word.
Okay, awakened fear. All right, and I will take care of that run sentence, Christine.
I think heinous things should be changed also.
To what?
Um, Because, how about just because of statements he has made?
Why?
Well, because things, heinous things he has said, just kind of like, you know, things he has said is, means statements, right? Things is just not a good word.
Okay, heinous statements, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, I guess what I feel like is, you know, how you want to show, don't tell, like, so... So heinous is one of those words that it's in the eye of the beholder, so it's better to be specific, like, you know. So I also feel like that's a word that could, like, make other people shut down and not want to read the rest of it.
Okay, and I feel strongly about heinous because I think he has said heinous things.
Yeah, well,
so
I do too.
So are we discussing whether he has said heinous things or not, or are we discussing how to characterize the things that he has said?
I think it's even a third thing, which seems to me is, how can we sort of get through to the largest number of people? And I think that we do have to be, I mean, I don't disagree with you, I totally.
Yeah. I'll just say statements, let's just keep moving on.
What about offensive? Is that a
No, let's just leave it as the statements he's made. We made it nice and vague and everybody can read into what they read.
Can we back up? This is your letter that you've written, you're going to sign it. Are we all signing this as the Human Rights Commission?
Yes.
So that's it's. So it's just tedious, but everybody has to be 100%. I'm sorry.
No, this is where I disagree. I'm a Puerto Rican woman, and I know what heinous is. And if there's any doubt about what heinous is, and I'm not saying for any of you it's not that way, it seems to me that I'm not talking about when he said if the sky was a particular beautiful hue of blue. I'm talking about very specific things that he has said, and we all know what he has said.
Okay.
And I don't want to repeat what he has said either. And I think it's heinous, and I thought that we all agreed that it was pretty hateful language that he used. So I thought heinous was the most incapacitating.
Hateful would be better.
Hateful?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I guess the thing is that I don't disagree. I think they were heinous, but there are people in Northampton who might not think they were heinous. They might think they were policy decisions.
But there has to be...
And I don't want to turn on
Mexicans
are your rapists
and
your murderers.
Many of the things he said have been held up as hate speech.
Yeah.
And they've been held up against that thing which we qualify as a nation as hate speech.
Yes.
We have hateful.
All right, hateful statements. Let's just move on.
We will not repeat his slurs,
yes,
nor detail his sexual assault, which he himself described, nor will we debate the presidential election.
Yeah, you have a different version than what I'm looking at.
Where did this version come from?
Maybe I printed an old one.
I think you probably printed an old one already. I did well, just so everybody knows, I created an original version. I sent it to Lori to edit it. She sent it back to me, and then I put in some of your edits and others I did not.
Yeah.
Do you remember vaguely when the date is that you would have sent it to the whole commission?
I didn't send it to the whole commission.
Wait, so how did we receive it?
Did I send it to
We had printed copies last year.
Yeah.
Because I have the December 14th email that just has the agenda. It would have been our last time.
Where did you get yours?
It would have been for November.
Didn't you print out copies and have them in a packet for us?
Yes, and I'm wondering.
It would have been for the November meeting. So sometime in November, I sent out there were a lot of, there were like four or five attachments.
And I'm very good at this, and I print out everything. So I've got my folders at home.
I printed out the attachment. I have it here, but it's not the same.
Is it your edit, though? Because remember, I went over your edit and I didn't.
I used yours.
Okay.
How different are they? Maybe it's just this one paragraph and I can move on.
Probably is a much.
She just added the sentence, it looks like. Because then it goes right with the Northampton. This is a new sentence.
Okay.
That she's added. So how do people feel about this sentence? We will not repeat his slurs nor detail his sexual assault, which he himself described, nor will we debate the presidential election. Do you mean the results of the election?
Anything about the election. I mean, I don't want people to think we're pro or anti, you know, whatever. It's just like, this is the reality. He's the president. I'm looking for this version that I sent.
That sentence seems fine to me.
I have a little bit of a problem with the accusation of sexual assault, only because that seems to me as if it could be read as slander. Those are not crimes that he's been convicted of, and a more litigious-minded person could easily see it as slanderous.
Well, he's a public person, so he can't sue for that.
That's actually not true.
How do we feel as a human rights, how do we as the Human Rights Commission feel about this being in our letter? We will not repeat his slurs nor detail his sexual assault, which he himself described.
I have no problem with that.
Well, is that in here?
Right.
No, this is the old version.
Did anybody
I received
see the
it. I received it on
where he says
November 23rd.
November 23rd.
That's when I'm looking at what
okay.
you sent that has that
okay,
letter.
So I may have it here then.
Yeah, and that's the one that you didn't send to me, and the, what you did send to me on the 28th.
That's the resolution.
What you sent to me on the 28th, the letter to the editor, is the old version, so I don't have access to the new version. But anyway,
paragraph two.
Go.
No one's
Well, we didn't work out the sexual exploit thing. Sexual assault.
Which he himself described.
Did anybody miss that he says where he grabs women? What part of the body he grabs women by?
I think we can.
And why he puts a Tic Tac in his mouth to kiss women?
Yeah.
Okay. That's what I'm referring to.
Well, we all heard it and saw it. The question is whether this is a good place to put it and whether we do it again. Whether we... You know, when I thought we were just saying we weren't going to go through what he did.
Well, we're not saying that. That's why we're saying sexual assault. Right?
How about we say behavior toward women?
How about we not water down what the things that he has done and said? As how about that we don't use that as our north? And do you know what I mean? I just feel like, why are we trying to protect this person instead of just saying, look, we know the things that he said, we know the things that he said that he's done, now he's the president-elect, this is the Human Rights Commission responding to that. What do you think of that?
What I hear in Ryan's comment is not about protecting the president-elect and more about protecting the integrity of this this government body.
How?
By being careful with our language, and can't actually, as Brian said, he's not actually been accused in court or had to face any charges on sexual assault. And that phrase, sexual assault, has a discrete legal meaning. So we can, I could, like Lori, we can find another way of saying it that doesn't put us in
he place. Has been accused in court. He hasn't been convicted in court.
Not a criminal court.
Because of technicalities, it has to be refiled.
And I would be comfortable with accusations of sexual mm-hmm. assault, but saying sexual assault, it's like saying that someone is a murderer because they once went to trial for murder.
It's also redundant because we've already said that our objection in the paragraph one is about how he has conducted himself. Mm-hmm. That's sort of a global statement about a person. How you've conducted yourself, and we've just detailed who he's offended, and it includes women.
Christine, you have made the best point of them all, and because I want to move on, yes, take out that. I completely disagree with the rest of you about why taking it out, but I agree with Christine, and that's the...
Okay. We, the Northampton Human Rights Commission, simply reaffirm all the articles in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights signed at the United Nations on December 10, 1948. The declaration contains 30 articles, and even as it uses language of its time when the word women was folded into man, which transcends all time, what transcends all time is the declaration's resolve on a basic principle that call on all of us to be above everything else kind to one another, that we are equal in dignity and rights. We have a right.
I'm sorry, I found the right version if you want to look at that. I don't know.
How are you going to take notes? Because you've been taking notes on this
one.
Yeah,
but that's fine. Because
okay, well, now I think
that's logical. Yeah, because I think that I took out that part.
Okay.
About, oh, woman was folded into man. I did leave that in. Because I remember you and I.
You left it in.
Yeah, and you wanted to take it out.
Yeah. Well, it's a long run-on sentence, and it's hard to follow it.
Yes, it's true.
And it has a little, like, revolution in the middle of it.
A revolution? What do you mean?
Excuse me, I need to start at the beginning with paragraph one. And this says, to the editor, The election of Donald Trump as President of the United States has caused terror in many communities right here in Northampton and nationwide. Arabs, blacks, Jews, Latinos, LGBTQ, people with disabilities, people with chronic illnesses, women and children, because of the heinous things he has said and how he has conducted himself.
Well,
and
how he has worked on that paragraph.
No, because this is different. And how he has conducted himself.
And the hateful things, I thought.
Yeah, we are. Yeah. It's just that this is the newer version.
But
he has conducted himself.
And then caused terror, awakened fear.
Yeah, no, I got that.
Okay.
And how has to be split into two sentences.
We're all gonna have another chance to get our last crack at this, aren't we? So you're gonna send it to us for a final?
Oh my God.
No, that's what can't be done.
Right. Okay.
Because of open meeting laws. So in other words, if we're voting on this today, we vote on it as amended.
Okay. Is what transcends all time is the declaration's resolve on a basic principle on the basic, it would have to be on, not A, on the basic principles that call on us to be above everything else, kind to one another, that we are equal in dignity and rights. We all have a right to equal pay for equal work, that the will of the people shall be the basis of the authority of the government, to peaceful assembly, to seek asylum from persecution, and that everyone has a right to life, liberty, and security. It's life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, but...
Well, no, but in the Declaration of Human Rights, I'm curious. It's not the...
Yeah, it's not the Bill of Rights.
Nothing quite compares to the UN's declaration signed by dozens of countries.
Wait.
Yeah,
before you go on, I think we should talk about that previous sentence.
What previous? The one?
The one she just read.
Oh, okay.
I mean...
Sure.
I mean, it's just like if we can't... We gotta go line by line. We can't see how else we can do it.
Yeah, stylistically, too, I think we need... more paragraphs, shorter paragraphs, and all kinds of stuff. So I think it would be useful if we could kind of do it in smaller chunks.
I'm going to ask a question. Is this a successful way for this to do this, or would you be willing to work with a subcommittee to write this rather quickly? Is somebody willing to?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, let's do this.
It's a lot of work, and you've put a lot of work into it and a lot of passion. And
but besides the passion, I think it's a smarter use of our time
to
have a small group.
Yes,
go
edit a letter,
line
and then bring it back.
It still will need to come back to the
Yes,
paper.
It will. But it will be a little tighter, and it'll be a little
so
less.
So who wants to be on the affirmation committee, letter committee?
Hold on.
Wait, I have something to say about this, because I hate to tell you, but I, because you know how... This is related to something that happened at the last meeting. At our last meeting, you and I agreed to be on a subcommittee to help with the film thing. And so I asked Lynn Simmons, is that okay? And she sent me, because it seemed like a simple thing to me, but and she sent me a link to the reference of subcommittees, which says, each multiple member body, because I wasn't sure, you know, did we vote that we were a subcommittee, or did we just like vote to co-sponsor and then say who's going to do the work? Does anybody remember?
Isn't
it in the minute?
It's a subcommittee.
It says.
No, there's no subcommittee.
Commissioners Loisel and Morris agreed to work as a subcommittee.
Oh, okay.
So it wasn't voted, but this is what it says. Each multiple member body may, by majority vote of its membership, establish subcommittees of the multiple member body for the purpose of addressing a particular issue or issues. A report of their activities shall regularly be made to the full multiple member body. Each subcommittee so established shall absorb laws relevant to the keeping of public records, the open meetings law, and any other applicable law.
I think if it's not a quorum, it doesn't constitute a quorum, then you're not obligated to do all the open meeting law things. That's my understanding of it, but
that's
wrong.
No, that's my understanding also, and I think we're both right.
Okay.
The subcommittees, people, you know, it's under a quorum, people can meet, make a decision, come to the full meeting, say, this is what we decided.
And that's where it's reported to the public.
Great. And everybody
else decides. Okay, good.
Okay, so Joe's on this, on the draft letter thing. Who else wants to be on this? Christine, because you brought up the idea.
Sure.
Okay. So can we meet, when, can we do a phone conference, if not meet in person?
That's fine with me.
Okay.
This is just a draft email. This is an email event.
This is an email event?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to email you a really nice cleaned up copy with no run-on sentences.
Okay. And then Joel and I will look over it, and then we can bring it to the next meeting. Okay. Thank you.
As a point of parliamentary procedure, do we have to, like, vote on the creation of a subcommittee? Is that a thing that needs to be done? Based on our city code?
According to what that just said, I thought the same thing, but according to what that said, I didn't hear that.
The only think you have
obligation
to,
is for the subcommittee to report.
Well, if it's,
I mean, we can appoint a subcommittee. I think the key with what that said is that subcommittee is bound to come back and report. Mm-hmm.
Do we want to decide what we're going to, you'll send us an email. Okay.
We can meet and get it done, but I mean,
No, Joel and I,
you can move to
your edit, then we can decide.
Yeah.
So you can move.
Okay.
So don't really
I'm very familiar with Robert's Rules of Order, so I'm not sure how procedural is appropriate.
Okay, so Christine, somebody want to lead on that. I'm sure it's going to be really
I would like to move that we vote upon the creation of a subcommittee to revise this affirmation.
I second that.
Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Anybody abstaining? Let's go to Councilor Lisa Klein with the Black Lives Movement.
All right, so like I said last time, this isn't a presentation by me by any means. This is a brainstorming session to look at the policy platform, and I should have handed these out when we first got here, because it's mine, because it's... So what I printed out is a kind of condensed version. So it doesn't have all the verbiage, but it gets to the main points, but I also have the original here up on my screen, so if there's any question about any, then we can refer back to them. So what I envisioned for this was that we as a commission would look at the six different policy headings. And maybe we could read each one and look at the specifics of each one. And then where somebody, anybody on the commission sees something that feels like there's some way, we have to think creatively here to pull out a way in which we can address part of this. And because this is very broad, I think they did a great job, but it's very big kind of conceptual ideas of what needs to happen with, massive change being called for. So what it behooves someone or a group that wants to actually, put some rubber to the road around it, what it behooves us to do is to figure out what the actual workings could look like. And it necessarily, I think, means kind of zooming in really close on one kind of piece we can do. So I would imagine that we could figure out two or three things that we can pull out of here and we can work on. And I have some ideas, but I don't want to limit our thinking as a group. So if it sounds okay to all of you, I'd like to just kind of go down and read these. And then when anybody sees something that, just has an idea about what it could look like to actually address a particular piece.
As the Human Rights Commission.
As the Human Rights Commission for the city of Northampton, because I hope that anything that we choose, we could probably get the mayor's office on board or get the city council on board to kind of bolster it. So maybe we could just go and read them.
Well, I propose instead of reading them one by one is that we take it by every section. So for instance, reparations, that we can read that ourselves and then, okay, does anybody have any comments about that? You know what I mean? Go. If anybody has another idea or your same idea, please let me know.
So we're just going to sit here silently and everyone's going to read to themselves and then come up with ideas? Is that acceptable?
or somebody can read it, whatever. There are two things on the table. Does anybody have a preference? You know, just let's express ourselves who wants, would prefer what, and we'll do it that way.
Well, I think if we read it out loud, then we'll all be done at the same time.
Okay, who's gonna read?
I'll start.
Okay.
And I'm not gonna read the whole thing, though. We all have to do this. End to the war on black people. We demand an end to the war against black people. Since this country's inception, there have been named and unnamed wars on our communities. We demand an end to the criminalization, incarceration, and killing of our people. This includes end to the criminalization and dehumanization of black youth, end to capital punishment, end to bail money, end to the use of past criminal history, end to the war on black immigrants, end to the war on black trans, queer, and gender nonconforming people, end to the mass surveillance of black communities, demilitarization of law enforcement, immediate end to the privatization of police, an end to all jails, detention centers, youth facilities, and prisons as we know them.
Are we going to discuss section by section or just read?
Oh, I thought that's what you said. Are we going to discuss it section by section?
Yeah, I thought we'd discuss section by section. Okay. Does anybody want to say anything about this section?
Well, we don't have capital punishment in Massachusetts.
Yeah, I think that's one way to do it, is to kind of eliminate what is obviously something we can't work on and try and home in on what we can.
I get a real sense of passion and power and strong language, which strikes me as ironic that we were just writing a letter to that we need to tone down. I'm just commenting on that I'm not sure that toning it down, which was my first instinct, is the right way, because this is powerful. Just sharing with the group. What's next?
Yeah. What Christine said.
A couple things that stood out to me here that seem like they could be very concrete, and that I know some work is already being done, so we could work to kind of amplify some work that's being done in the state, is the end to bail, because one of the things that is a number of kind of prison advocacy organizations right now in Massachusetts are working to ensure, essentially, bail creates a situation whereby people remain incarcerated who are in poverty because they don't have money to pay their bail. And they don't even have the sureties that they need to get bail bonds. So we're incarcerating massive, I don't know the exact numbers, but we're incarcerating massive numbers of people just because they're poor, because they don't have the money to pay their bail.
Well, can I just add something to that?
Yes, please.
We're not, that's not the real issue. The real issue is that the courts are clogged, because if we had an efficient court system, people wouldn't be lingering in jail. They would just get to their court, because really, you're just holding people in jail to ensure that they will attend their court date, because there are a risk to not come back to go to their court date.
No, the problem is bail. Because if they had money to pay the bail, they could get out, and you have a better chance of getting off.
But they're interconnected, because the reason that they're there is because it takes so long to get to court, so that people who can get out on bail will get out on bail until their court case comes up, so they're very much interlinked. But I just know, for instance, the real cost of prisons, a local organization is working on it, Prison Policy Institute, which is based in East Hampton, is a national organization based in East Hampton, is working on this. I'm not quite sure, and this is the kind of work we would have to do, the legwork we'd have to do, is find out what is actually happening in the state legislature. Is there anybody, are any of our reps or senators sponsoring any kind of bill to actually address this? I know that a whole new wing is being built on the women's prison in Chicopee as we speak, because the numbers are overflowing, and a good portion of a reason the numbers are overflowing there is because of the bail issue. So a lot of people have been working on kind of pushing back against the expansion of the women's jail in Chicopee. So anyway, there's just some room there, I think, to kind of figure out what is happening and see if there's a way we can amplify the work of another organization. So that's one place in this one that I kind of flagged. And I'm wondering if there are any that other people have kind of thought there might be a place we can move in on.
So one of the thoughts that I had thinking about this in the intermittent months that we've been talking about this, was in reference to the police data that our police department has released. And I know that we have released a large amount of raw data as a city on police interactions with minorities and with people of color of all races and ethnicities. But what I haven't seen is any form of workable trending or statistics on that number, on those numbers. So and a thing that came into my mind was to see if we could work with the mayor's office or with the city council in order to try and pass some form of policy that would help to create that sort of trending data. I mean, it would be good for us to be able to show that in our city, our police are doing this work and it's been improving in this way, or haven't. And that can inform policy just as easily.
What do you mean by trending data? Is that just like over the years?
The difference between like having raw numbers and raw data and actually having like a statistician create trends and say that, you know, over this time period we have correlative data that suggests that this is happening. And that's generally not something that a layman will be able to just look at a spreadsheet of data and tell.
Well, what I understood, both Lori and I were on the police chief's data, open portal data committee, is that what it's called, Lori?
The open data committee.
And then all that information that she has put up on the website, mm-hmm. that we went over line by line, she's the one, right, who is looking out for trends. And people...
Well, anybody who looks at it. I mean,
anybody who looks at it, right. But she's also certainly looking at that. And so then, Brian, I'm not sure that I understand. Like, I mean, I understand the part that people... You know, most of us do not know how to read a spreadsheet and find a trend in it. But given the size of the city of Northampton, these charts are not that, right?
Have you seen them?
Only briefly. So I looked at it briefly when I came up with this concept.
We looked at the way other bigger cities did it, and mm-hmm. that was like a data dump that was not decipherable.
Right.
So in Northampton, they made charts that were very readable mm-hmm. and showed from year to year. So that
okay.
you can see trends. I mean, no statistician did it, but it's pretty clear. The trends are pretty clear.
Okay, I mean, that's fair. I mostly just looked at data. I'm studying to be an analytical analytical sociologist, so that's a thing that I just look at is data. And I mean, if we have that kind of sort of massage data to be able to show correlation, I think in that case it would be the same. It would be the same notion of just, you know, publicizing that.
Yeah, I mean, we had a whole conversation about that you could buy an expensive kind of thing that would link to the community
right.
that would just like regurgitate the data, right? And then some cities are doing it, but it's like not very user friendly at all.
Mm-hmm.
And so they, and because we're kind of small and they don't have that large number, they could go
right.
year by year. And she chose to do it in a different way that was
mm-hmm.
a little bit more labor intensive, but more user friendly.
And the ends for me was more about being able to publicize that idea and either celebrate our city as, you know, as a city that champions these ideals of not having, you know, a war on any minority, including black people, or to be able to inform, you know, city council and the mayor's office of these potentially negative correlations that are in existence.
And also, you know, I asked the police chief separately about the militarization of police departments that's happening across the country. And I asked her, do you foresee yourself wanting to buy those weapons from the leftover from these wars,
the surplus
tanks, surplus. And she said no. She said she wants her officers to have the weapons they need, but she is not at all inclined to do what has been done in Ferguson,
mm-hmm.
where police show up and you feel like you're not even in this country anymore. And
I will say I lived in Fort Myers, Florida for a number of years, and when any form of larger than a couple of people incident was happening, armored personnel carriers would show up.
Oh, wow.
And that was telling to me, as opposed to here in Northampton where a few police officers, maybe even on bicycles, will show up.
Mm-hmm.
That feels very different, especially like as a queer man being out in a bar or something and a fight breaks out that may have, you know, some source that isn't just people being intoxicated. Seeing police officers showing up and defending not only the agitators but also like the queer community in Northampton, it feels very different for me than when I lived in Florida.
This is an exceptional community with an exceptional police chief. And I'll tell you quickly something that happened to a friend of mine and I, another Puerto Rican. We were in the parking lot behind Thorns in that open area. It was about this time, so it was nighttime. But I had the door open because I was going to get out to get into my car. And we were talking, and all of a sudden, two cruisers showed up and shined their lights on us. And I asked, what's going on? He said, well, somebody called in saying there was suspicious activity. I said, oh, no, we're just two Puerto Rican girls. Say goodbye. It takes forever. And, you know, they were totally, you know, it was fine. And and then I called the police chief. Of course, I called the police chief because we already have this relationship with the police chief. Would I have called her had I just been a private citizen as my friend? No. And I asked her, who called and, like, what did they say that two cruisers showed up? And she said, well, somebody named Nick called and said that you were blocking the way for other cars, which wasn't true because other cars, including the police cars, went right by us. And if they, that, you know, what were we doing there as long as we were there, which is, you know, 20 or 30 minutes. And that's all the information she gave. So that, to me, showed what I believe that this police chief would answer anybody's call. That it didn't need to come from me because I'm on the Human Rights Commission. Anybody called her and said, what happened that two cruisers showed up, you know, with their lights and everything. And she was able to explain it. So I think we're very, very lucky. Yeah.
And I suspect that would be the case. And I would just, my whole kind of means and ends was to kind of highlight what I suspected was the case here in Northampton and maybe be able to celebrate that. I mean, if we were able to, you know, publicize some kind of data, perhaps even Black Lives Matter here we could make that data available for them to put on a local website or something. I mean, to show, you know, this is a place that where we value many of these things that are on the platform.
You know, speaking as to add on to that, Lori. Didn't the police chief hire some people to come give some cultural competence classes to the officers?
Yes.
Remember?
Yep.
And I don't know if they publicized that, but then that would be something to publicize then. If it's not on their website, then at least for the Human Rights Commission to recognize that the police department has done that. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I suspect that we would be celebrating the way that things are going here in Northampton, but looking at trending and correlations, I would like to say we can celebrate, but in the instance that we couldn't, I mean, at least by looking at it and making the data like publicized and having people know where it is. I mean, I look at this kind of stuff every day because of my academic career, but my roommates don't know how to find it, for instance.
Yeah. So procedurally, I would just say that we don't have to make a decision, I don't think, until we look at everything. So right now on the table, I'm suggesting that we think about maybe doing something around participating in the ending bail. And there's another suggestion here on the table that we do a little bit of analysis of data around race and police stops and perhaps kind of publicize it. Although I know the police department does a pretty good job of kind of getting this out there, I just want to say. But so we have two things in this category, and I'm wondering if we can move on, but I think I saw out of the corner of my eye you guys were raising your hands or something.
Yeah, Karen.
I just, one thing that occurs to me is that there's statistical information and there's also anecdotal information, and one of the things that we might be able to do is to have a community listening session where we actually ask people who identify as African American how they feel we are doing in terms of, as a community, in terms of, you know,
the
litany. I think that's an excellent idea.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if the right word is awkward, but the fact that there are no African Americans on the commission makes it a little bit strange for us to be talking about what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong. And so I was struggling with that, but I think that is a perfect way to say, okay, help us.
I think that should be the topic.
We talked a lot in the past, and it's been this idea that's come up for months now to do a series of listening sessions with communities of color. And just because it kind of kept going off into the ether for some reason, I didn't continue to pursue it and brought this. It could be a nice dovetailing, I think, so I would love to do that. I think it's actually a project that's pretty deep and pretty complex. So, you know, maybe that's the one thing after we finish this, we decide we do want to do and relate it back to this somehow. But I think it would take a lot of planning to do it right and to do the proper outreach so it's not, you know, a bunch of people who aren't of the community necessarily doing it. And they're, when you do listening sessions in communities and you're trying to really get at real information, I think it has to be done with a great deal of thought and sensitivity.
Well, here's something for next year, but without getting too deep into it, if we do listening sessions by ward, and then we meet with the ward, the city councilor, the at-large councilor, and how are we going to reach the specific people we're talking about? The African Americans I know in Northampton don't necessarily want to come to a public meeting and say anything about Northampton in a public way. So for those of us who know African Americans, if there are black people, you know, people who are black who are not African American, and if they, we can ask them. And we can report back to the commission. We want to. Does somebody? Does that seem like?
Well, and previously I had asked if, you know, this piece of paper is great, but it doesn't represent Black Lives Matters necessarily in Western Massachusetts, which is where we live. And I had asked, is there an active Black Lives Matters group here? And I would go right to the source and ask them how they want help. I think about it as a lesbian, and if I lived in a community where I wasn't very well represented, would I go to the Human Rights Commission and say, it would make me just crazily vulnerable to tell the commission what they were doing wrong. It would not make me feel, or right, I mean, it would be a very awkward, uncomfortable position to be in.
But I don't think we're asking them to tell what we're doing wrong. We're asking them to talk about their experience in the city.
Okay.
Right, isn't that right?
Yes, I feel like we're getting too deep into the, I mean, if we decide in fact that that is one of the thing we want to do or one of the things we want to do out of addressing the platform, then I think we have to start going really deep into figuring out what it's going to look like.
Joe.
Yeah, and when we talk about listening things by ward and everything, I don't see how you can do it for just Black Lives Matter. I mean, how do you go out there and say, okay, we want to ask that? You're Puerto Rican, I'm sorry, we don't want to talk to you. We only want to talk to that, or you know, you're this or you're that.
Yeah.
If you're going to have a listening thing, it's got to be everybody. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you can segregate it. It's a scary word. But
that's actually
it goes back to your point of, is there a Black Lives Matter coalition? Or group that we can then go specifically to them and say, okay, we're looking at this. Do you have advice on how we can help?
That's a good point.
Just what I know about BLM 413 is it kind of foundered and dispersed over the last year, but what I've heard in talking to a bunch of people about this is that they're reconfiguring, but most of the folks are Springfield Center, a little bit in Amherst, but there's not a whole lot of participation from anyone here in Northampton. So that doesn't preclude that we would be able to pull folks from BLM 413 in, but there's not a real activity happening here in Northampton itself with the Black Lives Matter. But I mean, one of the things that's really interesting about this platform is that it comes out of the Movement for Black Lives, which is broader than Black Lives Matter, as it were, and it's a national platform. And again, not to say that we shouldn't include, of course, people of color who live right here in Northampton, but it's kind of this endorsed thing broadly, nationally, and so just using it as a jumping off point, I think, is valid, even if we, you know, don't have anybody that we're able to work with.
Well, I'm glad you said that, because in reading this and going to the website, that sure didn't come out.
What do you mean?
I saw it as purely for black people as I read it. I mean, it talked about transgender and all, but I thought it was all under the auspices of black lives.
Yes, black, transgender.
I didn't see it as a
There's actually a statement on the policy site that says something like, you know, we encourage communities to interact with this and to work on this. And so there is a way in which they've kind of put out that call nationally for
allies.
Communities to figure out how to interact with it.
They're also asking for groups to sign on as sponsors, endorsers, so that's something we can do too if we want to. Were you suggesting we keep moving because we might as get, but I just want to say one more about this section because one other thought, all of these things to me seem so large national scale, it's hard to think about how in Northampton we could do much concrete, but one thing I think is worth talking about, not now but later, is implicit bias training for law enforcement.
And also, you know, not just for law enforcement, for people who work in municipal government, it's for everybody. For teachers, for administrators.
Well, this section seems to be...
I understand, but, you know, when Joe says segregation, something happened in my brain where let's not focus so much on one section of society at the expense of others. It's just, because I'm also thinking about, has anybody here been to Casa Latina? Has anybody spoken with the people of Casa Latina what the issues are for the about 12,000 Latinos who live here? And that's important also. So we don't want to do like a Puerto Rican or Latino listening tour solely. We don't want to do a, like Joel was saying. And I agree with that. I think we should think about how do we, either as individuals, members of the commission, then seek out the people that we know or people who know, and then get that information and bring it back here. Or then connect with the Springfield, if the Black Lives Matter or the NAACP chapter there, and ask their representative to come here, and so we can ask some questions. You know, we can't go to Springfield, we can't hold a Northampton public meeting in Springfield, but we can certainly invite people to come here. And does that make sense to everybody or to most people? Okay. So who's reading the next section?
I want to add one quick thing just about bringing the kind of broad national scope down locally. One of the things that we can be thinking about in these different sections is even issuing statements or resolutions again. For instance, like following up on the question around militarization of police forces, we could write a statement that's kind of preemptive that says, we strongly encourage, you know, the police or whatever in Northampton not to, I'm just kind of using this as an example, to not purchase surplus military gear because it's not needed in the city, essentially. And so that we have something like that. If, in fact, one day the police chief changes and that police chief decides, yes, we want to, you know, get armored, whatever, and... So anyway, so that's the kind of thing that we kind of have the power to do, and it doesn't sound super impactful, but I think these things do matter, and they create discussion in the community. So that's a way to bring it down to kind of more local and what we can be doing.
Mm-hmm. I'd say that if we're going to talk about Black Lives Matters in our local community, I would say that the needs of the Black community have to be fairly invisible if the 8 of us who have lived here collectively a couple hundred years are not aware and fully, I'd say that would be our primary issue. If I were Black in Northampton, it would be that I would feel invisible. My needs would feel invisible.
No, I don't know who, I mean, there may be people who have Black friends, I don't know. But in terms of, are you talking about us on the commission?
I'm saying
representative in government? Or?
That I realize that is if we're talking about things local, because what I boxed in a circle here, are not what national things we can do, but it's what we can do locally, you know, and in the next section, you know, that's what I'm looking for, is to address what you said, Elisa, and what can we do locally? What our local issue is in Northampton is that we have a defunct Black Lives Matter group here, and that none of us feel comfortable representing and bringing forward issues. So I would say the issue is invisibility.
So a way to address that could be that the commission commits to doing proactive outreach to bring there's only one open seat right now, but to bring members from the African American community or the Black community to the commission. I mean, that could be something concrete, that's a commitment that we make and we write a statement about that.
I personally have tried to bring 3 Black people to join the commission. And it's very, you know, that hasn't happened, obviously.
Right.
So, let's continue to do outreach, obviously. But it's not always a successful result for different
reasons. We have 6 minutes, Chair.
No, we don't have to end at 6:30, do we?
Okay, let's move quickly through this because we have one thing. Lori has something at the end, and then there's some new business. Okay, reparations. Who's reading that? Are we going, are we doing this thing?
I'm taking notes,
so. Okay.
Reparations. We demand reparations for past and continuing harms, the government, responsible corporations, and other institutions that have profited off of the harm they've inflicted on Black people, from colonialism to slavery through food and housing redlining, mass incarceration, and surveillance must repair the harm done. This includes reparations for the systemic denial of access to high-quality educational opportunities in the form of full and free access for all Black people to lifetime education, reparations for the continued divestment from, discrimination toward, and exploitation of our communities in the form of a guaranteed minimum livable income for all Black people, reparations for wealth extracted from our communities via environmental racism, slavery, food, apartheid, housing discrimination in the form of corporate and government reparations, reparations for the cultural and educational exploitation, erasure, and extraction of our communities in the form of mandated public school curriculums that critically examine the political, economic, and social impacts of colonialism and slavery, and funding to support, build, preserve, and restore cultural assets, legislation that requires the acknowledgement of the lasting impacts of slavery, establishes and executes a plan to address those impacts, including passage of H.R. 40, the Commission to Study Reparation Proposals for African Americans Act, or subsequent versions, which call for reparations remedies.
Comments, questions?
Well, as I read it, I thought that the local impact, if we could do anything, our commission would be number four. If we wanted to interface with the public school system and do some sort of education, we ourselves could offer to host a forum for children or some sort of education to understand the actual deep-seated impact of institutional racism and slavery.
When you say interface, what do you mean?
Offer in some way to provide some sort of educational forum for a school. And that's, Black Lives Matter is suggesting this, and I think that's something that we could do locally. The other things seem bigger and not really.
Related to that, I think we could do an exploration, just kind of inquiry into what the school system mandates now in terms of
curriculum?
That kind of curriculum, and look at it and maybe make some recommendations to them, or work towards even some legislation that calls for the school system to, or we could work with the school committee so that they mandate if it's not mandated. But it would take some exploration. I think that could be really interesting.
Do you mean maybe I'm reading into this, inviting the principals of the schools?
I meant doing an actual educational forum where we could, bring somebody or go and present some information to children in the schools.
But then, of course, teachers, educators design.
Yeah.
And then we would just co-sponsor.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
The Arts Council has two cycles of grant making for arts projects in the city, and we could make a recommendation that one of their annual cycles would fund artists of color.
Would people then feel kind of if they, reverse discrimination type of situation?
I think
you're good. This entire thing will have that argument. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, I'm not disagreeing, whatever, but I can imagine that the entire Black Lives Movement, everything in this, somebody's going to scream reverse discrimination.
And the Arts Council can, take up the discussion and decide what they will, but our role of engaging in the conversation is engage.
Mm-hmm. Who's the head of the Arts Council, do you know?
Brian.
Brian.
Brian, who?
Foot.
The only other one that kind of stood out to me, and this would be a simple thing, it could be kind of an add-on thing, is number five, the HR 40. I read up on it. It's really an interesting piece of legislation that was sponsored by John Conyers, who's the majority whip, the minority whip in on the House Judiciary Committee. Is just right, even a resolution that we would send to the, or to his office or to the House Judiciary Committee, encouraging them to take it up in the coming term, because it's going to be discontinued as of January when the term ends. So asking him and saying, you know, we as a city support this at the federal level. And
Okay, a couple of things. One is, we're gonna be here so long if we read this one at a time. I've read through it. I hope everybody has had time to read through it, so we can really just take it section by section. Regarding what Karen just said, I can certainly call Brian Foote and just and ask him if that's something possible that they can do, if that's a lawful thing that they can do, to, or even if in the language you say, you know, we encourage, if they, you know, that line, we really encourage and we really want to hear from.
Process-wise, I think it is useful for us to go through the whole thing and like pick the.
But there's just a time issue, and we have other things.
Well, I see this as a project that kind of can be an ongoing project of the Human Rights Commission. I don't think we have to, you know, work through everything and resolve it now. I mean, we could agree over the next few months to do two sections each meeting or something like that, because this is, you know, a deep piece of work.
Right. So it's hard to make a. You know, until you go through it all, it's hard to figure out what concrete action you want to take.
Yeah, we're not deciding on concrete action necessarily. I'm just trying to acknowledge that this is what I'm doing. I acknowledge that it's 6:30. This is very long. It's very involved. And we have other things on the agenda. So maybe we can also postpone some of this and carry it over to the next meeting.
I understood you to say we were brainstorming. So, you know, that doesn't just end.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, so I guess I am proposing, as I can't make an official movement as a non-member, but I'm proposing that we could stop right now. We finished two sections. We've got some ideas written down and recorded, I think. That for the next few meetings, we take two sections and...
Yeah, we'll be done in 3 weeks.
I think that's a great idea.
Okay.
To see this as a long-term
right.
project.
So we
basically.
Will continue at the next meeting, starting with Invest and Divest. All right.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing this stuff.
Thank you for being interested in doing it.
Lori.
Yes?
You wanted to talk about the co-sponsorship at Mount Holyoke College of a film series?
Oh, right. There's one other thing we have to talk about.
Yeah.
But the co-sponsorship, well, I thought at the last meeting, we said we all wanted to look at it before we decided for sure if we want to do it. So I thought we had to talk about that.
Okay.
Am I right? Elisa sent a link, and did anybody look at it? Mm-hmm. So should we talk about that?
Okay. Why don't you start the discussion on it?
They seemed really good to me.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a documentary.
Was there anything, like, you thought that was controversial in the sense of, ooh, should the City of Northampton's Human Rights Commission be?
No, and you weren't here last time, but the Mount Holyoke College student is working within the context of a class.
Mm-hmm.
And the professor is this Northampton guy who's really great.
I wasn't able to see all of it, I only saw part of it, but the part of it I saw, I thought was pretty good.
I mean, I guess what I'm saying is it's going to be rooted in academics, it's going to be very well thought out. So,
have you guys had contact with Ellery since she was here?
No, I have not. I may have misunderstood. I thought she was going to get in touch with us, but that might have just
been. I think
been.
She left the meeting before we, because maybe she had to leave. I'm not sure.
Right. But I could have sworn she. I could have sworn she said, "Yeah, I'll get this information to you, or I'll contact."
Yeah,
you.
I gave her my card
that I forwarded, though.
Okay.
She didn't get in touch with you.
No, she hasn't.
She's probably on her break.
Yeah, she probably is. But I'll read that one.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I maybe that was one of those typical things about, well, she's not calling me, so I'm not going to worry about it.
Oh, one of the things I wanted to add to the conversation too is that I sit on the working group, the public education working group of the Refugee Resettlement Initiative, and Suzanne Acrolius, who came to our meeting, chairs that group, and she's really interested in working, if at all possible, with the Human Rights Commission and Ellery and the Mount Holyoke students on getting the film series together. And one of the things she said she could bring to the mix is recently resettled refugees from the particular countries for a panel discussion and possibly even some funding for food that's culturally related to the particular country that's being considered. So it might be useful to for the subcommittee to hook up with her to see.
And we're considering doing this in the room at the senior center?
That's one idea.
Which I have to say was a fabulous event, and I went and represented the Human Rights Commission at the Lives Worth Living film that was shown in that. It was the first time I've been there. It's a beautiful space and perfect for, you know, as many people as we get, we could.
Good.
Easy parking. So that would be a ideal location, I think.
You also have the tech capability to screen a film without any fuss.
Good. Okay. City Councilor Marion LaBarge thanked us for co-sponsoring that film.
Yeah, you know, that of us going to other city committees as representative of the Human Rights Commission, that's fantastic. I've done that also, and it really just enriches your experience as a Human Rights Commission member to go to any other of these committees.
Right, because that was the Disability Commission that was sponsoring it.
Yeah.
It was interesting.
So there are a bunch of city committees, and I encourage all of you, to look, see if maybe there's a meeting you'd like to go to once in representation of the Human Rights Commission.
There's one more thing from last month, which is we endorsed that resolution, and then I finished it up, I sent it to Lynn, and she was just gonna send it up to the city council, but then you mentioned that often what happens is somebody from the Human Rights Commission goes at public speak time and presents it to the city council. So I just wanted to clarify how we want to handle that.
And if you want more than public speak time, I can put it on the agenda, and you could take as long as you want to do a presentation about it.
It's traditionally what we've done always is we use the public comment. If you want the counselor to engage the counselors, as like Alisa says, then ask either Alisa directly or Pam Powers or Bill Dwight to get on the agenda. Actually, Bill Dwight being the president, that's where I went to when I wanted to get on the agenda.
So I just wanted to know what we want to do.
What does everybody want to do? You want to discuss your resolution? You want that to be a discussion at the city council meeting?
And do you want to make a specific ask of the council? You know, to like sign on to it, or I mean, there are different ways the council can interact with it.
So we sent it in, and the city mayor's office was going to take care of sending it to all the governor. It was like the whole list of people that we wanted to send it to, the governor, the attorney general, blah blah blah. So this is going to our local government. Sure. I don't know. I think just getting it out at a city council meeting is good. You guys did adopt something similar, so would it be redundant to ask you to sign on with it?
I thought we were endorsing their resolution.
That's true.
Well, no, did you? I don't know that you guys, I can't remember, did you actually, the key to what I think is really to me important is backing them. It's the mayor who said this is a sanctuary city, it's going to stay a sanctuary city, right?
Well, he issued the executive order to the police so that their procedures would be sanctuary city procedures. And then that we passed a sanctuary city resolution in support of it. Council asked the mayor to create the executive order because he's the boss of the police as opposed to
right.
the city council,
yeah.
So it had to be an executive order in order to enforce it.
Yeah.
But then the council issued a statement, and he issued the actual executive order that has the procedures outlined for the police.
So, and this was a few years ago, right?
the end of 2014.
So to me, what's different now is that we have a new president, and so to me, it's like important to say, we still want you to do this, even if it means losing federal money. So that's why it's different now. So if you guys haven't, I'm not quite familiar with everything you've done, if you haven't restated, we're committed to this, Mayor, and we want to keep doing this, even if it means we lose our federal funding, maybe you should sign on with us.
But the mayor has said he's going to do everything possible. He has no plan of backing down from Northampton being a sanctuary city. Now there may become a, there may appear a circumstance where the city could lose some federal funding that is so crucial that he may have to back down.
Right, or so, I mean, but if, here's the thing, if push comes to shove, there could be people in the city that say, no, we don't want you to do this. And I think it's just important for us to say, we support you even if there's backlash.
Well, I'm not necessarily agree with even if federal funding is lost, because some of that federal funding is, you know, we need it for roads, for sidewalks, for to make places accessible. So if anything would be, if that situation ever did come up, then we fight to still get the federal funding.
Didn't we have a discussion last time where it was talked about that the amount of federal funding is not huge for us?
It's like 4%.
Yeah, I mean, not that much, but it's not, we're not talking like 20% of our.
Well, what I loved about what we ended up kind of agreeing on was adding that piece that said that we encouraged the city to look for fundings for the most vulnerable populations, that we could lose funding because it's 3%, I think, of the budget, but it's actually CDBG money,
right,
which is specifically for Casa Latina's been a representative, one of the organizations received CDBG money. Veterans groups, I mean,
the SRO,
truly homeless, the Center for New Americans that is actually serving immigrants. So it's kind of this weird thing that if we lost that money, we would actually be losing those funds.
Or the city would find a way to make up for it, which is what we
right,
said.
And we encourage that. So if there, maybe that's the hook for the city councils to say, we'd like a new statement that resonates with ours, and we'd like you to sign on to this one that specifically says we encourage the city to seek other funds if we lose these funds that support vulnerable people, something along those lines.
So I think we should actually ask to be put on the agenda, because if we go before at public comment, they can't talk back to us. It's one of those, you know, things. So, but if we're put on the agenda, then you can come discuss
will
it.
Will you do that? Will you get in touch with Dwight and do that?
Well, I'm the liaison to the city council, so the whole point is that I can then kind of bring these things to the city council.
So can you put us on the agenda?
Yeah.
Okay. And who
then will you go to the city council and talk about this?
Yeah, or does anybody else who would like to go? Anybody here?
As many people as want to could.
Yeah.
I'll be happy to be there, but I would be very comfortable in you doing it and talking about it, because I think you can grasp of it.
Okay. Does anybody else want to come? Because
it depends on the date.
Okay.
Yeah, well, that too.
I think it's the 4th is the first Thursday of January.
The 5th is the first.
The 5th, so it's the 5th, the meeting.
And
you want
to
wait till the
5th, I'll be able to come with you.
If it's the 5th?
If it's January 5th, yeah. I have a point of new business, actually, that is procedurally about something.
Okay.
With me being locationally challenged for that.
Yeah,
okay.
I should be okay January 5th. When is it, in the evening?
7 o'clock.
Yeah, but when does... But it depends where it's put on the agenda.
Oh, it's usually, let me think, it's after the mayor does his, we have public comment, so if there's a lot of public comment, it could be as long as half an hour, it could be as short as 3 minutes, it depends on how many people show up. Then the mayor does his communications, which can take anywhere between 2 minutes and 10 minutes. So it's hard to say, it could be, you know, 10 minutes into the agenda, or it could be half an hour into the agenda.
Well, I can do it, and I'll do it. I'd love it if other people can.
Okay, so Lori's going to go to the city council meeting on January 5th, and you're going to be on the city council's agenda. You should read the resolution, too, so the public.
Mm-hmm.
Though now they put it up on the big screen as well, but still read it for people who don't see that far. And we'll see what happens.
I should be here.
Okay, great. And you can...
Yeah, assuming it's the 4th or 5th, yeah.
I can't come.
but thanks to all of you who can go. If there anything else you want to discuss about the film series?
Sorry. Oh, no, I just have a new business.
Okay, yeah, new business.
Okay, I have accepted an offer to go to London for 3 months to work with refugees. I'm going to be working with an organization called the Kappa Institute, so I'll be getting credits for university, as well as working with a nonprofit or a governmental organization while I'm there. Based on the city code that we were looking at last month, we have provisions for attending remotely, and I'm not sure procedurally what we need to do in order to get access to, like, plugging a computer into the screen so I can Skype in or something like that, but I'm dedicated to being here remotely over Skype or Google Hangouts or something like that. It's more just a matter of figuring out exactly what that procedure is going to look like so everyone can come.
And the time?
January 8th is the day that I fly to London, and I arrive home on April 22nd.
Well, good for you, Brian.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Good for you. Yeah, as Christine says, the time, though, I mean, you can have a leave of absence and just come back.
Honestly, it's not going to be a problem for me. I mean, they're
like
5 hours ahead, so it'll be about midnight, which is pretty much when I go to bed anyway.
Okay, that's great.
It'll help you sleep.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll be exhausted by the time I'm done.
So how do we do that, Elisa? Is this place wired?
It's really ironic because technically we're supposed to be able to do it, but it's never been done.
Oh, you're a pioneer. Yeah.
So we got a month to figure it out.
No, Elisa has a month to figure it out.
It actually needs to go to the mayor's office, I think, to discuss it.
And if there's anything that I need to do, any emails or phone calls I need to make.
Yeah. I remember talking about this in City Council, and it's not as simple as just having a computer with you on Skype,
right?
Because there are some, like, parameters around how it has to happen, and I think we might need to get, like, an LCD projector and da-da-da-da, and so someone is going to have to, like, technologically.
Do you want to ask Lynn about how to do this?
Do I want to do that?
Well, yeah, because you're the liaison to the mayor's office.
No, I'm not the liaison to the mayor's office. I'm the liaison to the city council.
Well,
the chair is the liaison to the mayor's office. Yeah.
Well, that's news to me. I thought that maybe you can help them with this, but okay, I'll take it on and call Lynn and ask her how we can do this.
I'm physically here until January 8th,
okay.
Until the afternoon. Well, I'll probably be leaving for Boston in the morning, but
if there's anything she tells me that is like, okay, then Brian, you need to do this, this, or that, then
absolutely, let me know. I can
okay.
I can come into City Hall, I can do whatever needs to be done, and I'm really computer savvy, so any instructions I'll probably understand.
Maybe you can tell City Hall
what we need. Natalia, I do a lot of remote meetings for my work.
Uh-huh.
If you'd like, I'd be happy to.
Thank you. Because that's techno deep talk that I'm not.
On your end, it'll be simple as Skype. It's more a matter of how we get the LCD stuff going here.
Any other new business? Well, here's my new business.
You have new business.
I do have a new business. I already told the mayor that I'm going to be resigning as a member of the Human Rights Commission. And obviously that means also as chair. So, but I'm not gonna resign as chair until you all vote in on the chair. So when we meet in January, I hope that there's at least one person who's willing to become the chair.
So as long as we don't vote for a new chair,
you're very
you
sweet.
Won't leave.
You know, I mean, you're very sweet.
As a point of order, legally
no,
we have to have a vote on those three offices that are critical.
Yeah,
we need to have a chair, a vice chair, and secretary.
Yeah, although I've been told that's not. I think it says you may. I don't think that it actually dictates that you have to have those.
No, you don't have to have those. We have had those. In fact, we have had co-chairs.
I have to look at it again.
So, at our next meeting, please think about if there's someone who would like to become the chair.
And vice chair and secretary?
We don't need to, the secretary, what is the secretary? The secretary, the person who takes the notes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, so it's Karen.
Well, it's tonight.
No.
Can we identify what our meetings are from now through June, perhaps?
Sure.
Okay, but I want to finish talking about
what please do.
I'm sorry. So I would like to thank you all, for those who have been here a longer time. You have all enriched me, and even in my most frustrating moments, I've learned from each and every one of you, and I appreciate that. I have a special shout out to Joel, because he's such a Buddha guy, and it really makes a difference in the world. That needs to be on the record. And then also to Lori, who's a friend of mine since I was, 26?
Child.
Yeah.
You're a child.
And you were what, 20? Thank you, you helped me a lot also with all this procedural stuff, and I really appreciate that. So it's made my being chair so much easier. So thank you. And to the new members, I don't know you very well yet, but thank you. I appreciate you. So,
thank you for your service.
Well, thanks for your service.
Thank you for your service.
I would like to say I'm so sorry because I was looking forward to meeting you.
Oh, well, thank you.
We're working with you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Davina. Well, I'll be here in January.
So you've decided you're resigning from the resigning from the commission.
And that will then open up another slot.
Yeah, right.
And then to really, you know, try to find, just bring more diversity, you know.
Yeah.
Hopefully I won't be replaced by another Puerto Rican, you know, only that there'll be another Puerto Rican in the ninth slot, or someone black or Asian, or, you know, just really diversify this board, which is very important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
you'll be here next month?
Yeah, I'll be here until you find a chair. I want to, you know, be responsible. And hopefully at the January meeting, you'll all decide on a new chair.
Christine, you go.
I
will go to the meeting.
Oh, yeah.
I wanted to just get the schedule the next 6 months. That's
we need the fourth Wednesday of the month.
Yeah, so.
All right.
It's pretty simple.
Can we ask for some clarification again from the mayor's office? Because it does say, in terms of the elections next month that we're going to do, each multiple member body shall annually elect from its membership a chair, vice chair, and clerk, and such other officer or officers as are deemed necessary. So does that mean that it's mandatory to have the chair, vice chair, and clerk, and any other officers are?
The verbiage would seem to suggest that those three are mandatory.
I'm on so many of these.
We have had,
and we've never had a clerk though, so that's why I'm wondering.
We have had co-chairs, and it hasn't been a problem. And if it's called a co-chair or a vice chair, that's fine.
Have you always had somebody, have you always rotated the minute taking, or?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no, depending on the composition of the commission at that time.
That is what most commissions do though, is they rotate the, so I think we don't necessarily need to elect a clerk, but I think we do need a chair and a vice chair. From my conversation with the mayor a while back, that's what I understood.
Okay, well, we can talk about the next
chairs, as you say, Natalia.
And then, so we'll continue to meet here. I mean, the commission will meet here then, Christine, because I see you're putting in your calendar, in your paper calendar. Respect. I have such respect for you. Seriously.
I usually use a pencil, too.
I have a paper calendar.
I know. No,
I just like to
look at that.
It.
Oh, look at that. Okay.
I have a question about that. We meet on the fourth Wednesday. We could change that, right? That's
yeah. The issue of changing that is, will this space be available?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. So
5:30, right?
Yeah, a couple times we moved it to 5, I believe.
Yes, I will do that.
Didn't we move it to 5 o'clock a couple times?
Yeah.
Just for convenience.
Yeah.
Well, does everybody here feel comfortable with the 5:30 on Wednesday, the fourth Wednesday? Do they feel comfortable? So that seems like a good thing then.
I mean, I'd love it at 5, but that's just me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, does everybody feel comfortable with it at 5 o'clock?
I find that it's harder for most people.
People work till 5, it's hard, but.
I mean, it
would be easier for me if I said.
Then let's leave it at 5:30. That's fine.
Okay. Well, we can talk about it, but I also.
Okay, so do we have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All right. Good luck, Brian.
Thank you. I'm very excited.